amazing how valuable a vine can be. California makes 85% of the U.S. consumed wine. It's the fourth leading wine producer after France, Italy, and Spain. In California, the conditions are just right, and the crops thrive there. People who work in vineyards know the importance of healthy vines. We visited a vineyard one time when we were down in Virginia with my daughters, when my daughter graduated college. And we took a tour of the vineyard, and it was my first time. How many of you have been to a vineyard? Yeah, it's beautiful, it's a beautiful sight. Well, this one in Virginia had rose bushes planted on the end of each row of the grapevines. And so, of course, I had to ask, why are the rose bushes there? And I was told that the rose bush is a visual sign. How healthy the rose bush is how healthy the vine is in that row right behind it. And I found that to be fascinating. Vineyards are beautiful, right? But it takes a lot of care and a lot of work. Jesus gave a spiritual value to the vine here in our gospel lesson. It all has to do with the vine. Vines are planted, vines are cultivated, vines are managed to do one thing and one thing only. What is that?
To produce.
To grow fruit. Absolutely. The thing that makes the branches of a vine valuable is the fruit that it produces. So we just read these words in John 15. Jesus says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. In this passage, there is a phrase that's repeated over and over again, and it is bear fruit. In these verses, we identify Jesus as the vine, God as the gardener or vine grower, and we as followers of Jesus, branches. The gardener only has one concern for the branch. He wants the branch to bear the fruit that the vine produces. And the vine wants the branch to produce as much fruit as possible. So what is our number one purpose? It's to bear fruit. That fruit, simply put, is the characteristic of Christ. One sure sign that you are a genuine follower of Jesus Christ is that your life is bearing fruit. And what is our fruit? It's the character traits we find in Jesus. Our fruit is love. Our fruit is joy, peace, gentleness. Sounding familiar? The fruit of the Spirit, right? And so on. A Christ follower is a disciple, is a branch attached to Jesus the vine. A branch has one purpose. It is to
produce fruit.
A branch by itself has no value. A branch that is disconnected from the vine, lifeless. We go to the grocery store and we can purchase grapes, right? Green grapes, red grapes, grapes. Nice, healthy grapes, okay? When's the last time you went to the grocery store and were able to purchase the branch? When's the last time you wanted to eat the branch? You don't eat the branch. The important part is the fruit. So apart from bearing fruit, a branch has no purpose. In other words, a branch finds its purpose in bearing fruit from the vine. So what the gardener desires for the branch is what God desires for you and for me, to stay connected to Jesus, the vine, so we will be fruitful. What gives the branch purpose and meaning and impact is the fruit. Just as the branch can only bear fruit if it's connected to the vine, we find joyful purpose and meaning in our lives when we make and keep the connection to the vine, to Jesus Christ. In our world of technology, we all know the importance of being connected, right? Life is all about finding the right connection, making the right connection, establishing a connection, keeping a connection, finding the next connection. It goes on and on and on. So we all know about being connected. Jesus tells us in this beautiful analogy that the way our life can have meaning and purpose and make an impact every single day is by understanding and following in his footsteps, connected, concentrated, and continuing in our relationship with Jesus Christ. So Jesus gives the best definition of a Christian right here. You'll ever read the scripture. Jesus makes something very plain. A Christian is a person connected to Christ that bears the fruit of his character. And do you realize that this definition makes Christianity the most unique faith in all the world? No other faith or religious system offers its followers a personal relationship with its founder. A follower of Christ, however, is called to be connected to, joined to, and always in communion with Jesus Christ. That's why so many people are so confused about Christianity. They confuse religion with relationship. And there's a difference between being in an organizational connection with Christ or having an organic vine connection with Christ. The organic connection comes first, followed by a desire to be with others in community to learn and grow together. We're the branch, we bear fruit. Fruit comes in a what?
Is bunch.
Bunch or a cluster or a you don't go to the store and get one grape. You get a group. And our community of faith is a group together. Right? If you claim to be a follower of Jesus, it's good to ask yourself this question once in a while. When people look at me, do they see a religion or do they see a relationship? Do they see a religion or do they see Jesus as I practice my religion? You can attend a church, join a church, and be baptized into a church, and that's all good in the faith community, right? But Jesus tells us here, we will not become a fruit-bearing branch until we are connected to the vine, Jesus Christ. And after we connect to Christ personally by believing in his life, death, and resurrection, then we choose to be a disciple of Jesus Christ every day. We concentrate on Christ exclusively. And this is described in verse 4. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Jesus reiterates that Christianity is all about the you-me relationship. You and God, you and others. If the branch wants to be fruitful and achieve its purpose, the thing it has to do is concentrate exclusively on its relationship to the vine. God the Father wants us to bear the fruit of the character traits we learn because of God the Son. Fruit always reflects the character of the tree or the vine. An apple tree produces apples, right? A pear tree produces pears. Right? Grapevines are designed to produce grapes. Right? Followers of Jesus Christ are to produce the character of Christ, the one to whom we are connected. Once you decide to become a follower of Jesus Christ, from that moment on, you enter into a lifelong process where your Heavenly Father, as a loving gardener, is going to do everything he can to maximize the fruit in your life. Jesus tells us he does this the same way a gardener does who tends for the physical vine. The gardener does two things with a vine to maximize its production. First of all, I found this very fascinating. First of all, a gardener continually positions and repositions the vine in a way so that the fruit can get the most sunlight get the sunlight they need, and they begin to wither. And so the vine grower comes along and lifts up these branches off the ground, brushes the dust off, and repositions the vine so the branches are hanging free so they can get the most sunlight. I'm going to ask you, has there ever been a time when you felt like you were laying on the ground covered in dust?
Yes.
Was there ever a time when there was a ray of sunlight, a phone call, or a text message, or an interaction, a smile from someone, where you felt like you were just picked up and repositioned? That's what we're talking about here. God picks us up and repositions us so that we can bear fruit. Many times things happen to us, and the only way we can figure it out is that God picked us up, dusted us off, and set us on the course again. God sends people in our lives to encourage us when we're down, or to answer a prayer through a person when we thought the situation was impossible. God is trying to reposition us where we can bear the most fruit for God's glory. And the second way that the gardener maximizes the fruit of the branch is by pruning. Ouch. Okay, pruning hurts. There are tiny little shoots that appear where the vine and the branch intersects, and they begin to suck the sap from the vine that ought to be going to the fruit. And these little branches must be pruned off. And if they're not pruned, the branch won't bear fruit. Have you ever had a time in your life when you felt like you were being pruned? We don't always realize it. We go through something so painful in our life, and we're trying so hard to figure out why is that pain there? Why does that pain continue? Sometimes you don't know. Well, I'm going to share a time when I was pruned. It's not in here, I'm just going to share with you. I was on the walk to Emmaus, and one of the talks on the walk to Emmaus speaks of this scripture and talks about being pruned. And I had lost my job at the school in March. The walk to Emmaus was in April, and I was, you know, in that low spot. Couldn't figure out why I would lose my job. What was that all about? And all of a sudden, when Pastor Joanne started talking about sometimes God prunes things out of your life so you can be more fruitful, and all of a sudden it hit me. Oh my gosh, I'm being pruned, and pruning is painful. And from that moment on, that epiphany helped me to understand that the pain I was going through was necessary, and that God had something better. And that had to leave so that something better could come along. Pruning is necessary, and pruning can be painful. And you know what happened that day when I was listening to that? All of a sudden it dawned on me, I was being pruned, and I just whacked the person next to me. It was Pastor Nancy, right? And I whacked her. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm being pruned. And she went, duh. And you know what it was? Everyone else saw it except me. Have you ever been like that? Sometimes you are such in the thick of it that you don't see it the way other people see it. That's when the body of Christ comes in. That's when other people come in to help you understand what's going on. That's the job of the gardener, to prune, to make sure that we can be as productive as possible. So using this analogy, it feels like sometimes God takes the shears of circumstance, tough times, heartache, suffering, and difficulty. And though we don't realize it, God is able to cut away those things from our lives, the things that are keeping us from bearing fruit. And too often we get bitter and angry because we fail to realize what God is doing, cutting away our arrogance, our pride, and our tendency depend on anything except God. Pruning is painful. Pruning hurts. But remember this, whenever the gardener is pruning the branch, it's because he considers the branch important and worth pruning to maximize its troubles and trials, heartaches and difficulties are signs that God doesn't care, and that we might be just floundering on our own, but we don't always think about it might be a time of pruning. So we continue to abide in Christ daily. The hand of the gardener, I love this saying, the hand of the gardener is never closer to the branch than when he's pruning the vine. Think about that. So there's only one command that is given to the entire passage of scripture that we've got here, and that is a phrase repeatedly used, abide in me. Right? The word abide means to remain, to stay, to continue. It simply means every day we are to continuously make Jesus Christ the center of our thoughts, the focus of our life, and the passion of our heart. Each day we make this choice to follow Jesus. And the only time a branch will not bear fruit is if something is blocking its connection to the vine. You cannot force a branch to bear fruit. You cannot command a branch to bear fruit. That's why nowhere do you find Jesus ever telling us to go out and produce the fruit. Our job is not to produce the fruit. Our job is to bear it. The way you bear fruit is by staying connected to the vine. So seven times Jesus tells us, verse 4, 5, 7, 9, and 10, all say, abide, abide, abide. Just stay close. Just stay connected. So here's where my simple illustration of the cup of tea comes in. All right, remember we just did this with the children's sermon. Let's see how it's going. It's getting darker, right? Okay. When you put a tea bag in a cup of water, what happens?
It gets dark.
Thank you. The water starts to steep and become tea. Why? Because they abide together. The longer the tea bag remains and abides in the water, the more the water will take on the color and taste of the tea. Right? If you want the tea to be stronger, what do? You leave the tea bag in longer. And that's what happens to us every day when we abide in Christ. We remain in Christ. We linger with Christ. We abide together. Now, the longer we abide together, the harder it is to see where the water stops and where the tea bag begins. So when we abide in Christ, the longer we abide in Christ, it will be harder to see where we stop and where Christ begins. Because the transformation of abiding together will become complete. We will take on the color and characteristics and flavor of Jesus Christ. You abide in Christ by simply combining your life and steeping it, by doing everything you can to continue abiding. You are no longer separate teabag and water. You're now creating something new by constantly communing together. We want to get to the point where there's a total communion in our abiding and you can't discern the water from the tea. Rich and full. Deep and rich in color, right? Let God talk to you as you study the Bible. Spend time with God in prayer. This is how we steep and abide with one another. Linger with God. When you're taking that walk out in beauty of nature, linger and meditate on the fact that God's creation is so beautiful around you. And when you serve others through acts of Christian action, that is abiding with God. Realize you are abiding in God's love.